Hello everyone. So today we begin with the clinical examination of facial nerve. We are going to do facial nerve examination in three main headings: motor examination, sensory examination, and secretomotor examination. So first we begin with the motor examination. Here we are going to check the actions of the different facial muscles. So first one, occipitofrontalis. How we are going to check the occipitofrontalis, whether it is a actions or intake or not? So ask person to look up, and while the person is looking up, you have to notice the horizontal folds over the forehead. So that is the actions of the occipitofrontalis muscle. Procerus, ask person to front the side of the glabella and observe the vertical folds. So that is how you have to check the procerus muscle. Orbicularis oculi, asked person to shut his eyes and forcibly try to open eyes while he or she tries to keep them closed. Tight closure or almost impossible to open the eyes, that is the normal action of the orbicularis oculi. So you have to tell your subject to close his or her eyes as forcibly as possible and try to open it with your index finger and thumb. If you are not able to open the eyes of your subject, then that is the orbicularis oculi muscle actions has been intact. Buccinator, ask him to inflate his mouth with air and blow out cheeks. Tap on the inflated cheeks with your fingers. It is not easy to make air escape. So you have to ask your subject to inflate his mouth with air and blow out cheeks. Tap on the inflated cheeks with your fingers. And if it is not easy to make air escape, so that is the actions of the buccinators are present. Levator labii superior elecunizae. Ask person to show his teeth. Observe prominence of nasolabial folds and angles of mouth. How to check the action of levator labii superior elecunizae? You have to tell your subject to show his teeth, and you have to observe the prominence of nasolabial folds and angle of mouth. Orbicularis oris, ask person to whistle. So you have to observe whether he is able to whistle or not. So that is what the action of orbicularis oris, ask person to whistle. If the person is able to whistle normally, then that is the orbicularis oris muscle actions has been intact. So how to check whether the actions of the platysma muscle is present or not? You have to tell your subject to clench his teeth, and you have to observe the prominent in the neck, muscle prominent in the neck. Stapedius, and in this we have to look for the abnormal hearing, and there must be no hyperacusis. Occipitofrontalis and orbicularis oculi muscle have a bilateral nerve supply. These two muscles almost cover the upper half of the face, and they having the bilateral nerve supply, while all other facial muscles have contralateral nerve supply. Now here it is the sensory examination. In the sensory examination, we are going to check the taste examinations. So you have to tell your subject to close eyes and nose and examine sweet, sour, salty, bitter taste from the anterior two-third of the tongue. So here the anterior two-third part of the tongue is supplied by the facial nerve. So you have to examine whether the taste sensations of the anterior two-third of the tongue is intact or not. Next it is the secretomotor examinations, and here we have to check for the taste for lacrimation or Schumer's taste. And here the important thing you have to mark that secretomotor fibers of the facial nerve supplying the lacrimal gland, sublingual gland and submandibular gland, but here it is not going to supply the parotid glands. That's why here we are going to check the lacrimation via the Schumer's taste. And how to check the lacrimation taste? So take two strips of filter paper of same size and length, hang them from the lower eyelids of both eyes, as subject to smell lacrimating stimulant. On the paralyzed side, if one side is paralyzed, then what will happen? There will be the little or no moisturizing of the filter paper. So it is a simple test. You have to take a two strips of filter paper of same size and length and hang them from the lower eyelids of both the eyes, as subject to smell lacrimating stimulant, so that there will be the increase in the lacrimation from the eyes or the from the lacrimal gland. And what will be the result? If there is a paralyze on one side, then on that side there will be the little or no moisturizing of the filter paper. So that is the secret to motor examinations, and here it is the test for lacrimations or Summer's test. Okay, now we are going to see the upper motor neuron and lower motor neuron lesion in the facial nerve damaged. So we are classifying the cranial nerve damage into the supranuclear lesion and infranuclear lesion. The supranuclear lesion cause will be the stroke, cerebrovascular stroke, whereas the infranuclear lesion, there will be the, it is condition is known as Bell's palsy. So inside the supranuclear lesion, paralysis of the inferior 1/4 of the face, and there will be the contralateral to the lesion. Upper part of the face is innervated bilaterally by the upper motor neuron, but inferior half having the contralateral innervation. So here the upper half of the face having the bilateral innervation, that means the fibers having both side from the right side as well as left side, but in the lower half of the face having only contralateral innervation. Inside the infranuclear lesions, paralysis of lateral half of the face ipsilateral to the lesion, as the fibers carrying the lower motor neurons that are supply the entire lateral half of the face are in the facial nerve. So once the facial nerve is damaged, the ipsilateral paralysis of the lateral half of the face. I think you are still confused. Let me clear these things. So this is the right side of the cortex and this is the left side of the cortex. And here whatever you are seeing, these two are the cranial nerve nuclei. Alright, the upper one you are seeing, it is the cranial nerve nuclei which supplies the muscles of the upper half of the face, and this lower nuclei, it is the supplying the lower half of the facial muscles. Now here the cortex, from the right cortex, whatever the fibers coming and joining the left half of the cranial nerve or the facial nerve nuclei, having supplying the both the upper half as well as the lower half of the facial muscle nuclei, and it is also sending the branches to the upper half of the same side of the facial muscles. Now if we are speaking about the left side cortex, and whatever the upper motor neurons from the left side going to send their branches, one branch on the upper side of the facial muscle it is going to supply, and on the opposite side it is going to supply the both upper half as well as the lower half of the facial muscles group of the nuclei. So here you are going to see that this upper half of the on the both side having the both the supply, means they also having the ipsilateral supply as well as the contralateral supply. Ipsilateral means on the same side, contralateral means on the opposite side. Alright, but here in the lower half of the facial muscle having only the contralateral supply, that means this left side of the facial muscles of the lower half of the facial muscle supplied by the right side cortex, whereas the right side of the lower half of the facial muscle is supplied by the left side of cortex. Clear? Okay, for example, there is a supranuclear lesion. So this considered as a cranial nerve nuclei. Alright, supranuclear means above the nuclei of the facial nerve there is a damage. So either the axons of the upper motor neurons are damaged, or already the upper motor neurons are damaged. For example, the lesion is over here. Okay, so what will be the damage? There will be the upper half of the facial muscles of the same side, they are not going to get the fibers from this, as well as on the both the upper half as well as lower half of the left side of this whatever the muscles are not getting the impulses from this right side of the cortex. Clear? So but here the important thing is that the upper half of the facial muscle having the bilateral innervation, that means they are also innervating from the same side as well as from the left side. So if the same side fiber is damaged, then it will be the covered by the left side. But here the most important thing is this fibers of the lower half of the contralateral side are damaged or are not getting any enough impulses from the motor cortex of the opposite side. So what will happen, we are going to see the contralateral paralysis of the inferior 1/4 of the face. So inside the right cortex damage, there we are going to see the facial nerve paralysis of the muscles of the inferior 1/4 of the contralateral side. So if the right cortex is damaged, the contralateral inferior 1/4 portion is damaged. So it is damage occurring inside this. Alright, so this is part is damaged. Now what is facial nerve? So here it is the facial nerve. Both the nuclei of the facial nerve and their fibers forms the facial nerve. Okay, so inside the infranuclear lesions. So infranuclear means these are the nuclei, and below the nuclei there is a damage. So here there is a cutting of the facial nerve. So you are clearly seeing that once this facial nerve is cut on the same side, the person having the ipsilateral side of the paralysis of the lateral half of the face. So once this facial nerve is damaged, so the whatever the muscle fibers of the upper half of the this left side are paralyzed, as well as the lower half of the left side are paralyzed. So here clearly you are seeing that the lateral half of the left side of the all the facial muscles are paralyzed. So inside the infranuclear lesions, the paralysis will be on the ipsilateral lateral half of the face. But inside the supranuclear lesions, the paralysis of the facial muscle will be on the contralateral as well as the inferior 1/4 part of the facial muscle are only paralyzed inside the supranuclear lesions. Alright, I hope via this presentation everyone is understood about the whatever the thing is occurring inside the supranuclear lesion and infranuclear lesion of the facial nerve paralysis. Now the Bale's palsy. What is Bale's palsy? It is a condition that causes a temporary weakness or paralysis of the muscles in the face. It occurs when the facial nerve is inflamed, swollen or compressed. So this is the introduction of the Bale's palsy. Now what is the or which are the causes of the Bale's palsy? The virus or bacteria that have been linked to the development of Bale's palsy. This includes the herpes simplex virus, which causes cold sores and genital herpes. HIV, you already know that HIV, it is the human immunodeficiency virus, which damages the immune system. Sarcoidosis, which causes organ inflammation. So these all are the viruses, and what is the role of these viruses in the development of different types of disease. Herpes zoster virus, which causes the chickenpox and shigellosis. Epstein-Barr virus, which causes the mononucleosis. Lyme disease, which is a bacterial infection caused by the infected ticks. So in these all these virus infections or bacterial infection, there are chances of facial nerve inflammation, swollen or compressed. Now which are the signs and symptoms? So first one, it is the drooling. What do you mean by drooling? It is the flow of saliva outside the mouth, difficulty in eating and drinking, inability to make facial expressions such as smiling or frowning, facial weakness, muscle twitches in the face, dry eye and mouth, headache, sensitivity to the sound as there is a no action of the stapedius muscle, irritation of the eye on the involved side. So these are the signs and symptoms of the Bell's palsy. So there will be the drooling, difficulty in eating and drinking, inability to make facial expressions such as smiling and frowning. There will be the facial weakness, muscle twitches, dry eye and mouth, headache, sensitivity to the sound, and irritation of the eye on the involved side. Mostly the Bell's palsy symptoms improve without treatment, but still we have to give the different type of medications, for example corticosteroid drugs which reduce the inflammation, antiviral or antibacterial medication which may be prescribed if a virus or bacteria caused your Bell's palsy. So if there is a reason or cause behind the Bell's palsy is virus or bacteria, then we have to provide the antiviral or antibacterial medications. Over the counter pain medications such as ibuprofen or acetaminophen, which can help to revive the mild pain, and eye drops we are going to prescribe to our patients of the Bell's palsy. So this is the treatment portion of the Bell's palsy. I hope via this presentation everyone understood about the Bell's palsy as well as the how to check the facial nerve. And if you like this presentation, please try to share with your groups.